Hey folks, there's a couple of things I want to discuss. First, I want to point you to a really interesting, exceedingly well-researched book, The Rise of the Evolution Fraud, Second Edition by Malcolm Bowden. It looks small, but the print is fine. Lots of information in there about how evolutionism was never science in the beginning. It's not today. And about how secular men in science and academia had a coup which removed, with the intention of removing and locking out people who believed in creation, even men of science of the day, from academia and science, you see, so they could control the education system and academia and the scientific community from that moment forward, which they have continued to do. You can label me a couple of things. Clearly, I'm a Christian. Clearly, I'm a fundamentalist Christian. I'm okay with that label. You can label me a creationist. You can label me a young earth creationist. All of those things would be correct. One thing you can't label me as, you could also label me as a King James onlyist, if you like that title, that label. You can use that too. I'm happy with that. One thing you can't label me as is a Romanist, a Calvinist, an Arminianist, or a Lutheran, or any of the other ists relating to doctrine. Because I don't believe in doctrines of man. You know what I believe in? I believe this. If it's in there, I believe it. I've said this before, it's a silly analogy. I make it to make the point. If it said, Space Monkeys Chapter 2, and God said, let there be pink space monkeys making pizza on Mars, and it was so, I would believe it, because I believe this is the inspired word of God himself. It's not, could not have been produced by man. The authors who wrote these books down, penned them, state themselves the words were given to them by the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is Christ. The gospel tells us that the Godhead it existed in him fully and bodily. Jesus wasn't part man and part God. He was fully man and fully God. And yet, he gave himself up to be tortured and crucified for us. You know, Christ said, no greater love is there than a man putting his life down on the line for his friends. Jesus also called the apostles friends. Did you know that? He said he had not called them servants, he said, but friends. I call you friends. That's so many words. Isn't that amazing that God thinks of us as a friend? Not just our master, our creator, our teacher, and all these things, but as a friend. So, being someone who believes fully in the gospel, you know, that the Bible is the inspired word of God, and believing every word in it, you know, I believe what I read when I read the Bible. I don't need a guru to interpret it for me. Do you really think that God needs us to say, oh, master, sage, what does it mean when the Bible says such and such? God didn't write his word that way. There are things that need study to fully understand. God knew there would be. He wants us to dig our heads into his word. But the preponderance of the scriptures were not written in such a way that they need heavy work to interpret them or to understand them. We should be able to read the Bible and accept what it says when it says a thing. Do you not believe it? Where the Bible says, in the beginning God created the world, the heavens and the earth. Do you not believe that? God intends for you to believe it. Because it's so. Science is proving it. Has discredited the materialist worldview. Science has revealed that God did create it. You see, evolutionism and materialism, these are ideas born in a day when man rode horses and used candles and oil lamps to light their homes. Modern science has revealed God's word is true. God did design and create everything, this universe and all of its life forms. But when I read, this isn't going to be about creation, this video, though. It's not that. It's about whether or not you believe the Word of God when you read it. I do. Do you believe it? Is God not fully capable of saying what he means and meaning what he says? Come on. If there ever was an author, there is none greater than God himself. And the book we call the Bible is actually comprised of many books which were authored by God and given in the Holy Ghost to men who penned them down. The words are God's. Even when it says, "And so-and-so said unto them," it's God writing that. Do you not understand? God said this. I believe the Bible whenever I read it. Whatever it says, I believe it because I believe the Bible is the inspired Word of God. But there are people who try hard not to, and they want you to believe that you need someone to interpret these scriptures for them, to help them understand them. That, you know, when the scriptures were being translated into English, there was a lot of work done by the Roman Church to silence these people. Their Bibles were collected and burned. These men were burned at the stake. They were tortured and killed for trying to bring God's word to the people. Now, do you not believe that that was the work of Satan, trying to prevent God's word from reaching the masses? Well, of course it was. But God prevailed, didn't he? Of course. And his word is now printed for people all over the world to read. You know, Revelation states that the end won't come until the Word of God is preached to all the four corners of the earth. And by the way, what it means by four corners, it's a reference to a map that we look at in front of us. It's not a reference to the shape of the earth. The Bible states the earth is round. In Revelations, it discusses one taken from the field working during the day and one taken from bed at night, both taken at the same moment in time, one in the day and one in the night. So one is on the light side of the earth and one is on the dark side. The earth has to be round. See? Furthermore, God set the ordinances of the planets. The Bible tells us that. Didn't say he set the ordinances of the dishes in space. But I believe the Word of God when I read it. And you should too. You don't need a guru to interpret the Bible. And this, you see, denominationalism is really a work of Satan that caused division, you see. That people would believe traditions that are thousands of years old, even some that came to be before the Gospels were even written. So they would believe that over what they actually read when they read the Bible. And that would cause personal doctrines, human intellectual philosophies, philosophizing away the Word of God and coming up with their own human doctrines and saying, look, the Bible says such and such when it really doesn't. Because they're interpreting it. You know, the Bible says it's not for personal interpretation. But that's how doctrines, human man's doctrines, have formed all the different Christian denominations that exist. This divisionism is the work of Satan. You see? Because man philosophizes away what the Bible says instead of reading it and believing what it says when we read it. Do you think God knows how to say what he wants to say? I do. I think the Bible says exactly what God intended to convey. And we should believe every word of it when we read it. We don't need to interpret it in special, fancy ways. We certainly don't need to derive human ideas and create human doctrines when we read it. Doctrine is produced by Scripture, not by man's interpretation of it or his opinions. So, if you're somebody who doesn't believe in the Bible, that the Bible says what it says, if you're one of these people, I'm going to read to you some passages that for many people, they would interpret these as saying, oh, well, that's, you know, what that really means is, you see, they would immediately try to apply their human impersonal, interpretations of these scriptures, because they don't want to believe what these passages clearly say. They don't want to believe that. So they say, well, what it's really meaning, what it refers to is. So you have to understand, and now we need other passages to go back into the Bible so we can see these, and they tell us what that one means. See, as if this one doesn't mean what it really means, and we have to interpret their person, they have to package some other scriptures to try to put together their personal interpretation so we can say, see, this is what that passage means. See, doesn't mean what it says when you read it. It means what I say over here. And you see, that's what people do. And that's just wrong. So here are some verses that if you like doing that, you may not want to believe. Okay? 2 Samuel 22:16. And the channels of the sea appeared, and the foundations of the world were discovered at the rebuke of the Lord. The foundations of the world were discovered. This is creation, you see. Remember that it says foundations of the world. The creation of the earth. Foundation of it. The foundations are the mantles of the earth. When they were laid, God created them. You see? Psalms 18:15. And the channels of the waters were seen, and the foundation of the world were discovered at thy rebuke. There again, God creating the foundations of the world. And it took place when? Fast. Right? In a day. Matthew 13:35. Now it gets sticky. Stick with me. If you like interpreting the Bible for yourself and not believing exactly what it reads, what it says when you read it, these passages might just be for you. Matthew 13:35. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. Means, from the beginning, when God created it. See? The foundation of the world. See, that's when God created it. Remember, we go back to the passage where it describes his creation. So, whenever the Bible refers to since the foundation or from the foundation of the world, it's talking about the creation. And that means in the beginning, because the Bible says the very first lines of God's holy word is, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. See, Luke 11:50. That the blood of all the prophets, which was shed from the foundation of the world, may be required of this generation. Are you kidding? Their blood was shed from the foundation of the world? How can that be? Well, think about it. You might figure it out. But does the Word of God say exactly what it means here? You betcha. Did God mean what he says? Absolutely. John 17:24. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. This is Christ talking. Which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. Before the creation. Ephesians 1:4. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Let's read that again. That sounds kind of tricky, doesn't it? I'm not sure I want to believe that. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Gosh, you know that passage says that God chose the saved before the foundation of the world. Before he created this place. You may not want to believe that. Hebrews 4:3. For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said. As I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. These things were established and decided before the foundation of the world. I don't know. Maybe God doesn't know what he's talking about. Hebrews 9:26. From then must he have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Of himself. See, Jesus Christ is God. God sacrificed himself. He suffered our sins from the foundation of the world. Now, I know, the Bible really doesn't mean what it says. You got to interpret it. 1 Peter 1:20. Who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. Foreordained. Revelation 13:8. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Let's read that again. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Those that are on the earth will worship him, even those whose names are not written, were not written in the book of life of the Lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world. 17:8. The beast that thou sawest, and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. When they behold the beast that was, and is not, and yet is. Let's read that again. I don't know if God knows what he's talking about, right? It says, and they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. So you mean God is saying that some people's names were not written in the book of life from the very foundation of the world? When God created, we got to go back to foundation. What does that mean again? Oh, that's right. From the beginning, kind of like Genesis 1, right? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So you don't suppose that God means in Revelation 17:8 that there were people whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, and that there are those whose names were written in the book of life from the foundation of the world? Because didn't we read some of these other passages that said so? Do you believe what the Word of God says? I do. If that's what it says, that's what I believe. I believe it. Because I believe what the Word of God says, and I believe that it is the Word of God, and if it says it, I believe it. Alright, so what about those whose name was not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world? Well, let me ask you something. If you're a Christian, when did you become saved? Was there a day, a moment, a time in your life when you knew that you had become saved by God? Let's say it was 10 years ago. Did you know 15 or 20 years ago that you were going to become saved by God? You really didn't know, did you? If you're one who was saved by God 4 or 5 years ago, did you know 20 years before, or 10, or 5, that you were going to be saved by God? No, you didn't know that. Neither do any who are not saved right now, including any who call themselves atheists, neither do they know if they will be saved by God. There are plenty of people who are and have been professing atheists that have become saved by God and never would have believed it. There are people who preach the Word of God who just years ago called themselves an atheist, who argued against the existence of God or his creation with Christians. But now they're preaching the Word of God. God can do anything, and he can save anyone he chooses. There is no way that any of us can know ahead of time if we are going to be saved. And any who call themselves atheists today do not know with absolute certainty that they will or will not be saved by God. They'd have no way of knowing if their name was or was not written in the book of life from the foundations of the world.